Friends, welcome to my channel. This is your Govindraj. You all have made me proud with your views and share and likes on my previous videos. Thank you all, and please continue to do that. And now, in the previous video, I talked about a layoff as an option of employers. Now, in this session, we will discuss about the retrenchment as an option. This topic is not very easy also, because it comes with a lot of legal compliances and it takes a lot of time. However, in this video, I will try to give you a brief understanding of this topic, and which will help you to, you know, further investigate and also take further actions. And this is the time, friends, every employer is required to find alternatives and save his business. And the managers are also faced with lot of challenges in these circumstances. Therefore, it is important to understand this topic also. And if you look at the retrenchment topic, importantly, it comes to our mind what kind of categories of employees we have and whether we can retrench or not. And what is retrenchment is also important. So if you look at in India, the employment scenario, we have you know, two kinds of employee categories, which is, one is the workers which are covered under section 2S of ID Act, which is the major legislation for protection of workers, and another category of employees who are non-workers. Basically, these are management staff, managers and supervisory category. However, for these kind of people also, there are certain legislations which basically welfare and social security legislations are also applicable. However, the retrenchment is quite easy, or the termination of employment is quite easy, these kind of employees. But it's not so with the workers which are covered under section 2S of the ID Act. One more thing I would like to tell you, like in India, we do not have a hire and fire policy. So we have no hire and fire policy, and we have a sustainable and also you know, protection of workers kind of a, you know, labor legislations. So in India, the employment is like a marriage. So what happens in the marriage, you get married by your you know, free will, but however, you can't get away easily after the marriage. You have to follow certain you know, legal legislations and also discussions, all those things. There are you know, provisions which restrict also the getting away from the marriage. So it is like that. Even the employment situation is also is like that. The employer is free to recruit people, as many as he wants, and on different remuneration and other things. But however, when you are going to retrench or terminate employees, then it's not so easy. It comes with certain restrictions and prohibitions which the employer is required to follow. These are also important, because if suppose the employer has got hire and fire policy, then he can, you know, retrench or terminate whenever he wants. Then the workers are left with problems and issues, so their life also get affected. So that is why these are also important. And for an employer, he has to choose what kind of employees he needs, how many he needs, and when he is terminating or retrenching such people, then he has also should look into all these provisions and then do it. So this is with this brief, let's start this topic and let's see the presentation. Friends, as I told you, there are two types of employee categories, which is, one is workers which are covered under ID Act 1947 section 2S. The other one is employees covered under employment contract or employment order. So this has already been briefed you and all in my previous video. Now, if you look at today's circumstances, there are other categories of employees and resources where the employer uses, which are trainees under the standing orders. You might have employed trainees with your training scheme under the standing orders, and you have apprentices under the Apprentices Act 1961. You also have NEEM trainees, because the government has given this possibility by way of a notification under NCVT, National Council of Vocational Training Department, or the institute. You also have contract resources. These are the briefly, these are the four categories of resources any employer will be having in his establishment. Now, if you look at whether they are covered under workers category or section 2S of the ID Act 1947. So, trainees under the standing orders, which are basically the apprentices kind of a thing, section 2S of the ID Act very much covers trainees under this provision. However, whether you can dispense their services or not is a different legal issue, which we will discuss about in the going ahead. And then apprentices under the Apprentice Act 1961, these are governed under this statute and they are not clearly workers, which is a set law in this regard. And the NEEM trainees, they are covered under different scheme and contracts, okay? But whether they are workers or not, it depends on your situation, how you are utilizing them, what kind of practices you have in the establishment. That's why we will also discuss this also very briefly. And the other one is contract employees. See, these contract employees are very much covered under section 2S of the ID Act 1947. So how you can dispense, who is responsible, and how can you get away from them, these are all issues which are legally have to be deliberated. So we will also try to cover briefly in this discussion. Now, if you have to understand what is retrenchment, you will have to get into the definition of section 200 of ID Act 1947. ID is nothing but Industrial Dispute Act 1947. This is the definition which is available in section 200 of Industrial Dispute Act. I'm not going to read you entire definition and bore you with that, but I'll give you in very simple sense what is retrenchment. See, in simple, termination of service of workman for any reason is called as retrenchment. You terminate the services of workmen, not the other employees who are not covered under section 2S. The workers who are covered under section 2S, and if you terminate their services, then for any reason, then it is called as retrenchment. However, the termination can happen for different reasons. That different reason is, for example, anybody does a misconduct and you follow an inquiry procedure or a disciplinary procedure, then you dismiss him. That is not called termination under this definition, because when you classify this as a retrenchment or termination, there are certain restrictions which are available under the ID Act 1947, especially Chapter 5A and 5B. Therefore, you will have to very clearly understand whether the termination of service, what kind of termination of service amounts to retrenchment. So, as I said, termination for the reason of misconduct and disciplinary action is not a termination. And if the services are separated due to retirement, whether it is voluntary or superannuation, it is also not retrenchment. And sometimes you will have a fixed term contract with the employees, with the workers basically, and then non-renewal of that contract is also not called as retrenchment. And the law is also given, suppose if any worker is, has got a long time illness, then if you terminate because of that reason, is also not called as a retrenchment. So briefly, we understood what is retrenchment by this definition. Now, the question is, it is important for employers that whether you can retrench these kind of employees or not. So we will have to understand by different categories of employees whether you can retrench or not. So as I said, first category is the employees which are not covered under section 2S of ID Act. These are basically supervisory, managerial and management staff, and they are not covered under the ID Act. So now these people, the answer is definitely yes. However, you will have to look into the appointment terms and what kind of terms you have agreed with them. And subject to that condition, you can dispense their services. And also, you can negotiate the terms and with them and have a fresh contract and go on. So this is very easy and for an employer to manage this. However, we have another situation where these are called as workers or workmen, which are under section 2S of the Act, and these people are covered under Chapter 5A and 5B. The 5A and 5B talks about a layoff, retrenchment, closure and transfer of undertaking. So when you are doing a retrenchment other than the reasons which are excluded from the retrenchment definitions, so there are certain restrictions and prohibitions which you need to follow before you retrench. Now we have other categories of employees also. For example, now I talked about other resources for an employer where he is utilizing already. One is the trainees under the standing orders. Now the question is, they are very much covered under section 2S of the ID Act 1947. However, can you retrench them is the question. Now, these trainees have been recruited for a training for a limited period of time. Suppose you have made a promise and they are recruited to fill up a permanent position, then you have a problem. However, you just give a training as per your training scheme, and then they are not, the employer is not obligated to give employment, then you can dispense their training after the completion of the training. However, if you have made promises and then there are different terms and conditions in the offer letter, which training offer letter, which helps the trainee, then you are stuck in that case. So that's why, my friends, please be careful when you have trainees in your company. Now let's come to apprentices under the Apprentice Act 1961. See, these people are not workers. They are covered under this scheme, and the government has enacted this law to enhance the skill of workers so that they get employable. So that is why it is a very set law that the apprentices you engage under Apprentice Act 1961, and there are different scheme under that scheme also. For example, National Apprentice Promotion Scheme. So when you engage these people, they are not clearly workers, and you can dispense, or when they complete their training, you are not obligated to provide the permanent employment. Now let's come to NEEM trainees. These are the special kind of resources you have, especially from the last 2 to 3 years, where the government has given a flexibility for the employers under the Earn and Learn program, so that the employers gets the resources and the people whom you recruit, they also get the training as well as the employment opportunities in the future. As per the notification of NEEM, then you are not obligated to provide employment. Of course, you will have to follow certain conditions, like you have to provide the minimum wages at least applicable for the unskilled categories, and then so these are all things are there. They are not covered under any statutory obligations like PF, ESI and other things. However, off late there are certain cases are coming which says that suppose you hire a NEEM trainee and you don't follow the training scheme in spirit and in principle, and you just utilize them as workers, then you have a problem. So that is why this also needs to be deliberated in details. I will sometime I will cover this topic also in the later days. Now you have contract employees. See, these contract employees is also easy to dispense. However, one problem occurs when you count the number of workers for application of Chapter 5A and 5B. You are required to also count contract employees. That is where the problem comes. However, if you hire contract employees under the law, which is you are not violating at least the Contract Labor and Regulation and Abolition Act, and you have a valid contract, and you don't supervise them, and then the principal employer is not responsible. However, the contractor who employs them will be the employer of these kind of employees. So when you are dispensing the services, you will have to look into all these aspects also, and take a proper care. So I've given you a little bit brief about how can you dispense these resources, and if you have any clarifications or doubts, you can always write to me or talk to me. So then I will be able to give you a right perspective of it. Now, as I said, in India, the employment is, you can take people for employment free, but however, while sending them out or terminating their services, you have to follow certain restrictions, or there are certain prohibitions. So these prohibitions are contained basically in Chapter 5A and 5B. And this Chapter 5A and 5B application is how many workmen you have. It's not the employees you have, how many workmen you have. And these workmen are the number of the count is calculated by average per working day in the preceding 12 months. So you have to consider this. So when you are counting, you have to count all workers under Section 2S and not other employees. So this is the brief for you before we get into it. Now, what is application? See, there are different kind of industries. So when you have to understand this industry type for application of Chapter 5A and 5B. Now, if you look at a factory, mine, plantation having 99 and below workmen, then the Chapter 5A is applicable. So Chapter 5B is not applicable, because Chapter 5A has got certain restrictions for certain industries, and Chapter 5B is also has got some special provisions. That is why I am telling you whether Chapter 5A is applicable or Chapter 5B is applicable for a particular type of industry or industrial establishment. Now, you have factory, mine, plantation having 100 and above workmen. For this, definitely very clear, the Chapter 5B is applicable. Now, you have industrial establishment other than factory, mine and plantation. So any other industrial establishment other than factory, mine, plantation. For this very clearly chapter 5A is only applicable where there is a lot of flexibility for employers to dispense the services of workers. So if you follow the conditions, then it's very easy for them. Now you have another kind of establishment which are seasonal establishment, or where you don't have a permanent work, which where the work is carried out very intermittently. In this case also chapter 5B is not applicable. Now I have told you the applicability of chapter 5A and 5B. So if I go on explaining what is covered under chapter 5A and 5B, then it takes a lot of time. However, I'll give you a very brief of what is chapter 5A and what is chapter 5B. So when you look at chapter 5A, you can retrench the services of workers by following the conditions which are provided under chapter 5A. For example, you have to give a notice of 1 month, and you have to give a retrenchment compensation of 15 days average pay for every completed of year of service, and then you have to give a notice to the government, and then you can do so. However, under chapter 5B, you cannot do so if it is a factory, mine and plantation. For other establishment, of course, any kind of other establishments, then you are free to dispense under chapter 5A. But however, factory, mine and plantation are special, and then before retrenching you have to take a prior permission from the government and also give 3 months notice, and of course the compensation remains same. So these are the brief which I have explained you. However, friends, this is not the end. I only told you a trailer of it. So the abhi picture baki hai. It's not the full picture. So if you want to know more details, I think there is a webinar which is announced already on 13th June 2020 by Niratanka, which is an NGO. So you can register. In the previous video, I have given you the link for the registration, because this topic comes with a lot of other complications, like for example, what is the retrenchment compensation, then how do you calculate average pay, how do you count the numbers, what are the implications of retrenchment compensation, what is the procedure you follow, and what are the other conditions which are available, which are there under the law. So these are all associated concerns which you need to know before you retrench any employees. So therefore you will have to understand all the provisions and then get into this topic. So that is why I advise you to attend this webinar, and you can register it. In the summary section of my channel, I have given you the previous video link, so you can get into it and then register it. So I will sign off at this moment. Friends, thank you very much for all the trust and love and affection so far you have shown me, and keep watching this channel. Share this knowledge to all the people whom you think relevant, and stay tuned, friends. Thank you very much and see you soon.